As the sun reached its height above the deep blue waters of the Mediterranean Sea, a ship traveling from Ptolemais was nearing the city of Caesarea. A man named Paul stood at the bow with his companions, looking out towards the city ahead. The Apostle Paul had been traveling for years throughout the Eastern Mediterranean, from Palestine, Syria, and Cyprus, throughout Asia Minor, the Aegean Isles, and the peninsula of Hellas. Now, he and his companions, one of whom, Luke the Evangelist, were heading to the holy city of Jerusalem, stopping along the way in different cities to visit the Christians of those parts. As the ship docked and St. Paul with his companions disembarked, they spotted St. Philip waiting for them. Thanking God for reuniting them again, they embraced each other. Philip, one of the 70, called the Evangelist, was one of the 7 deacons appointed by the apostles to serve in Jerusalem, so that the apostles could freely teach the good news, travel, and spread the gospel. Among other duties, the 7 were in charge of distributing food and other resources to those in need. St. Philip was best known, however, for his energetic and passionate preaching, which led him to travel across Palestine, performing miracles and converting many. According to the Acts of the Apostles, Philip was the one who brought Christianity to his hometown of Caesarea, where he settled to raise his 4 daughters. Caesarea, a thriving city at this time, was named after Caesar Augustus and was constructed by the Jewish puppet king of the Romans, Herod. This was the political capital of Palestine instead of Jerusalem. Its harbor was more extensive than the Piraeus port of Athens, and the metropolis gleamed with the white marble of Greco-Roman temples and civic centers. According to Josephus, it was also adorned with pagan sculptures that rivaled any in the Roman world. It was in the home of Deacon Philip that St. Paul and his companions remained for several days. Here they were tended to by St. Philip's 4 young daughters, Eftichida, Irais, Callisti, and Hermione, who were filled with the Holy Spirit and had the gift of prophecy. It can be ascertained from the texts that Philip's daughters prophesied to Paul about what would happen to him if he went to Jerusalem. In Tyre, the faithful urged him not to go as well. Soon after Philip's daughters prophesied, another prophet named Agabus came to St. Paul and warned him about the imprisonment that awaited him in Jerusalem. In spite of all of this, the Apostle Paul remained firm and said, "Why are you weeping and breaking my heart? I am not ready only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus." Saddened by his words, they conceded, "The Lord's will be done." Soon after this, St. Paul continued on his journey to Jerusalem, where he was captured and subsequently transferred to Rome, where he died a martyr. The four daughters of Philip were, alongside their gift of prophecy, also adorned by many virtues. One of them, Hermione, stood out in her wisdom, compassion, and love of learning. She was particularly gifted in the art of medicine and healing, which she was deeply passionate about. She spent her youth immersed in the study of medicine in her hometown of Caesarea, becoming an exceedingly skilled physician and growing in spirit through prayer and dedication to God, as well as preserving her chastity and purity throughout her entire life. The world into which Hermione was born was not predisposed to prioritizing the poor and needy. She saw everywhere a general lack of organized care for the sick and poor, and was deeply inspired by her father and the disciples of Christ, who from the start of their ministry made it a point to care for those less fortunate. She saw that the world needed the light and mercy of Christ. The Greco-Roman concept of philanthropy was not inspired by the love of God. It had more to do with honoring those who honor you, and, last of all, if ever, the sick, the poor, and unfortunate, who were often regarded as more readily inclined to do evil, and for that reason, their poverty was commonly seen as their own fault. But Hermione grew up and was formed with the words of Christ in her heart. "Truly I say to you, whatever you did for one of the least of my brothers and sisters, you did it for me." Hermione understood that we should see Christ in each person we encounter, showing love to all, for God loves all people created by Him. Around the year 100 AD, Hermione left her hometown with her sister Eftichida and journeyed to Ephesus, hoping to find the apostle and evangelist John the theologian to receive his blessing and learn from him. Upon arriving, they were deeply saddened by the news that the saint had already fallen asleep in the Lord. All alone in this bustling new city, they prayed to Christ to reveal to them his will, trusting that he would lead them on the right path. Not long after, through God's providence, they met a servant of God called Petronius, a disciple of St. John. Petronius took them under his tutelage, helping them grow in the Spirit even more. With the help of her new teacher and spiritual father, Hermione, who was already skilled in healing the body, also learned how to heal and tend to people's souls. Ephesus, lying on the southwestern coast of Asia Minor, was one of the ancient Mediterranean world's largest and most important cities. At the time of Saint Hermione, it was the Roman government's provincial seat in western Asia Minor. But more importantly, it was a place from where the word of Christ grew and spread. The first bishop was the Apostle Timothy, appointed by St. Paul. St. Paul himself spent 3 years living and teaching in this metropolis. In addition, St. John the Evangelist lived for a long time and finally reposed there as well. After settling in Ephesus, Hermione, guided by the Holy Spirit, decided to buy a house and open a medical clinic dedicated to treating the poor, homeless, and less fortunate. This original home of healing and hope went on to become the first Christian hospital in Ephesus. Her kindness, love, and compassion led her to treat everyone equally, Greeks, Jews, and Christians. She worked diligently, refusing compensation for her work, and living humbly and simply, never thinking about her own needs, but instead putting all her efforts into healing the bodies as well as the souls of those who came to her seeking help. Hermione drew strength and courage from the words of Christ. "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Word spread about the kind and skilled physician, not only in Ephesus, but throughout Asia Minor. And people in need of healing traveled from far away seeking her help. As more and more people needed her care, Hermione added more rooms to her hospital to accommodate everyone. When she was unable to heal a patient with medicine, she would pray fervently over them, and God would quickly answer her prayers, healing the person of all diseases. Saint Hermione became one of the first unmercenary healers, setting an example for future Christian physicians. Some of Hermione's contemporaries were Zinaida and Philonila, cousins of the Apostle Paul, who also opened a home for the sick and homeless in Thessaly. These hospitals, also called xenodochia, would become central to the Orthodox Christian tradition of charity and hospitality over the next centuries. In the year 114 AD, Emperor Trajan stopped in Ephesus on his way to fight the Persians. The pagan Greeks of the city were enraged by the success of the holy woman, for she was not only healing people, but also performing miracles, prophesying, and converting many to Christianity. And thus, with the arrival of Trajan, the enemies of the faith saw an opportunity to rid the city of her. They informed the emperor about the problems she was causing them, to which he ordered her immediate arrest and to be brought before him. Trajan was a very competent Roman emperor who saw Rome's success primarily as a result of the favor of the gods he worshipped. He generally did not seek out Christians to persecute, but he could not ignore a person who had been converting pagans to this religion, which he considered a strange Jewish cult. Hermione, at this point, a woman advanced in age, stood before the emperor with an air of dignity, looking him straight in the eyes without fear. Surprised by her boldness, Trajan attempted to convince her to renounce her god and to offer sacrifices to the idols. But Saint Hermione firmly refused to obey the emperor, remaining faithful to Christ. Irritated by this, Trajan ordered to have her beaten about the face. The saint peacefully endured the beatings, praying to God to give her strength and courage. Trajan was observing the beating of the elderly woman when he heard Hermione's voice call out to him. He immediately ordered them to stop so he could hear what she had to say. Hermione began to prophesy that he would be victorious in the coming confrontation with Persia, and that his son-in-law, Hadrian, would succeed him. Trajan did not know what to make of it. Was she merely saying this to get out of her punishment? Or was this elderly woman actually able to see into the future? It seems that he immediately recognized that this was no ordinary woman. And now, knowing of her unusual gift of clairvoyance, as well as her great philanthropic work, he decided to release her, going on his way and ultimately fulfilling her prophecies. This greatly disappointed the pagans of the city, who hoped to get rid of her. Glorifying God for preserving her life, she returned to her hospital, continuing to treat her beloved patients tirelessly for 3 more years. In accordance with her prophecy, Hadrian came to power in 117 AD. The new emperor was informed about the well-known holy physician and prophetess, and ordered the woman to be brought before him. Saint Hermione, bent with age, white hair under her headscarf and hands withered from the many years of hard manual work, calmly faced yet another Roman emperor. Hadrian questioned her about her age and family, to which she firmly replied, "Christ knows how old I am and where I come from." Angered by her refusal to reply to his inquiries, the emperor ordered her to be stripped naked, ruthlessly scourged, and put into a cauldron filled with boiling tar and sulfur. As Saint Hermione calmly entered the cauldron, the fire was extinguished, and instead of tar and sulfur, she was standing in dew. People stood in awe around Hermione, who appeared to be illuminated with an otherworldly light. Shocked by this miracle, Hadrian wanted to confirm that what he saw was real. He reached out to touch the cauldron in which she was still standing. The moment his hand touched the metal, his skin boiled and melted, and his nails fell off. As he stumbled back in agony, Saint Hermione triumphantly exclaimed, "Behold, O Emperor, the Lord God lives." To this, Hadrian, blinded by rage, ordered her to be placed on a red-hot frying pan and be tortured without mercy. Saint Hermione fearlessly stepped onto the fiery pan with prayer on her lips, putting all her trust in her beloved bridegroom Christ. Just then, with a flash of light, an angel of the Lord appeared, shielding the saint with its wings. The fire dispersed away from Hermione and towards the spectators, burning them instead. The cheering turned into cries of pain as the crowd attempted to escape the fire and the mysterious being protecting the strange woman. After the commotion and noise died down, Saint Hermione, still unharmed, addressed the emperor and requested to be taken to a pagan temple so that she could sacrifice to the gods. Perplexed, but simultaneously pleased by her request, Hadrian immediately fulfilled her wish and brought her to the Temple of Hercules. In the temple, Hermione stood surrounded by marble statues of Greco-Roman deities. In front of her, a wide staircase led to a beautiful golden statue of Hercules. The people who made these sculptures clearly put a lot of work into depicting these so-called divinities. Yet, Hermione was able to see through the beauty. She was not dazzled by the artisan's brilliance. For her, There was no appeal in worshipping objects which depicted selfish, petty, and loathsome beings whose behavior resembled more those of demons than of the loving God she had known her entire life. As she stood there, filled with righteous anger and pity for all those who worshipped these demons posing as gods, the saint began to pray fervently. Her prayer was so powerful that suddenly the statues and the building itself began to shake. As she continued praying, cracks formed on the sculptures, and these gods were shattered into pieces. Hadrian, now consumed with rage, declared that this blasphemous sorceress should be put to death at once. The saint was handed over to the executioners, Theotimos and Theodulos, to be beheaded outside the city. But before the soldiers could lay their hands on her, terrified, they realized their arms had become paralyzed. The holy physician calmed the distraught soldiers, and placing her hands on them with prayer, healed them of their affliction. The executioners fell to her feet with tears in their eyes, glorifying the god of Hermione. The spectators saw this and urgently sent for more soldiers. But before the new executioners arrived, Saint Hermione, glorifying Christ, joyously gave up her soul in peace. Like a golden arrow, her soul flew straight into the loving arms of her Christ. And thus, the entire Christian world gained a remarkable saint and bold intercessor before the throne of God. The holy unmercenaries of the early church would ultimately revolutionize philanthropy. The Greco-Romans often marveled at the love and dedication Christians showed to the sick, the poor, the homeless, and all those who struggled in this world. And when Constantine legalized and embraced the faith of Christ, the Romans created the first large-scale and organized hospitals and centers to care for the elderly, orphans, and the homeless. Their philanthropic efforts transformed the entire world based on the love and mercy of Jesus Christ. In Eusebius's ecclesiastical history, we find a reference from Bishop Polycrates of Ephesus, who, in a letter, speaks of Philip and his daughters, saying, "For in Asia also, great lights have fallen asleep, which shall rise again on the last day at the coming of the Lord, when he shall come with glory from heaven and shall seek out all the saints." Saint Hermione, pray to Christ to heal us both in body and in spirit.
Your Lamb Hermione calls out to you, O Jesus, in a loud voice. I love you, my bridegroom, and in seeking you I endure suffering. In baptism I was crucified, so that I might reign in you. And I died so that I might live with you. Accept me as a pure sacrifice, for I have offered myself in love. Through her prayers save our souls, since you are merciful. You were an untouched virgin, remaining revered, and were wedded to him who was born of a pure virgin, and spoke in the flesh. Therefore you were granted, divinely granted grace, to contend for piety, to enlighten those in error. Therefore, Hermione, Christ glorified you. Your Lamb Hermione calls out to you, O Jesus, in a loud voice. I love you, my bridegroom, and in seeking you I endure suffering. In baptism I was crucified, so that I might reign in you, and I died so that I might live with you. Accept me as a pure sacrifice, for I have offered myself in love. Through her prayers save our souls, since you are merciful.